Good evening, Rangers fans. My name is Erica Lindsay Ayala. Thank you for joining us for Black History Night presented by Chase. The New York Rangers will celebrate Black History Month throughout February, highlighted by tonight's game. The Rangers are proud to show their commitment to diversity, the game, and the fan base, as well as featuring those who will continue to lead the global fight for racial equality. We have a fantastic panel lined up to discuss the Black experience in the sport of hockey, actively supporting equity, the growth of the game, and more. We know you're excited to hear from our guests, so let's jump right in. First, I'd like to welcome former New York Ranger and current MSG Networks and NBC hockey analyst, Anson Carter.
Erica, good to see you.
Good to see you too, Anson. And we have also joining us, Anson, NWHL's Metropolitan Riveters defender, Saroya Tinker. And we're going to talk a little bit about both of your experiences playing the sport of hockey. So Saroya, Anson, again, thank you so much.
Thank you for having us.
So we're going to go ahead and jump right in, and we're going to go with age before beauty, Anson. So that means you're up first. Can you just share your experience as someone who's played hockey and also being a person of color, a Black player in hockey?
Yeah, it's my experience is pretty similar to a lot of other Black players that played in the National Hockey League when I came through, Erica. And I always had another Black player playing on my team, believe it or not. When I say similar experience, I mean the negative stuff that happened. But all throughout my minor hockey career in Toronto, I always had another Black player playing on my team. Even we won the championship when I played junior, we had like four Black players on my team. So it wasn't until I went to Michigan State University that it became evident that I was just, you know, there's something different about my game. And how that came about, and you can appreciate this because you're in the media business now, is reporter asked me, well, Anson, how does it feel being a Black hockey player? And I turned and looked at him and I said, how does it feel to be a white reporter? And he kind of looked at me, he was stunned, but then he got the point what I was making. Like, I wasn't out there just trying to be a Black hockey player. Like, I know exactly who I am. When I look in the mirror, I know I'm a Black man. But first and foremost, I want to be a good hockey player. And that was it.
Absolutely. And Saroya, you have been very vocal and open about your experience as well. But being a player of color, being someone, a Black player in the women's game, has your experience and opportunities kind of mirrored what Anson said? Or what has that been like on the women's side of the game?
Yeah, for me, I think that that's so awesome to hear that Anson was able to play with other players of color. Me, throughout my career, I didn't play with another Black player until my senior year of college, and that being just this past year. So I find that my game growing up, I was always somewhat excluded from my team. I knew I didn't look like everybody else, and I knew that I didn't quite fit in. And with that, I think that my teammates weren't always supportive of me being a different race and having a different experience in the game as them. But growing up and making it to where I am today, I think I've made it clear that we have a voice in the game now. And it's so awesome to be able to see these little girls behind me be able to play and not have those same struggles that I had.
I appreciate you offering that, Saroya, being honest and open about that there were times that you've struggled in your career. You've talked a lot about your experience at Yale and how there was a coach that helped you overcome some of those feelings of, being distanced from your own teammates. So thinking about that, those conversations with your coach at Yale, but then also thinking about your first year with the NWHL and also having to find ways to have conversations that might be a little bit difficult or conversations that some of your teammates haven't quite honestly had before. Can you talk to us a little bit about how you navigated that and how your teams at Yale and then with the Riveters were able to navigate that together?
Yeah, for sure. I would say that at Yale, I had a coach my senior year come in and want to understand why I wasn't loving the game. And through those conversations, I was able to express to him why I felt like I wasn't being included and what I think the team can do better and improve on in those areas. So moving forward, I think I've always been a very outspoken person. So I've been comfortable sharing my experiences now playing at the professional level, just because I think we've gained that level of respect and can speak to those issues. And with that, with the NWHL and with the Riveters, I've had a lot of uncomfortable conversations, but also ones that have allowed us to develop as a team, getting to know each other as players, and also develop as a league, and be more inclusive and really focus on those diversity and inclusion pieces. But all around, I think that it's so important for coaches and teammates to get to know their other teammates, get to know who they're coaching and what their backstory is, as I think that that can help so many players along the way.
Again, I appreciate you bringing that up. And I do want us all to talk a little bit about recognizing allyship. But before we do that, Anson, you've shared your experiences briefly. You've heard Saroya walk through hers. What advice would you give to young Black players, regardless of gender, that are coming up in the game that may experience some of the things you both have and may have to have, as Saroya mentioned, some of those difficult or awkward conversations?
I think, Erica, it comes down to staying true to who you are and having that strong, tight circle. Like, I was pretty blessed and fortunate to have my mom and dad, that they hammered home every single day, life isn't fair, but don't let, if someone treats you poorly, don't let that affect the way you see the next person. So you're going to come across a lot of conscious and unconscious bias. You might come across a lot of racism, but don't let that affect you. There's so many different times when I had contract disputes when I played that other players didn't have to deal with. And I had the same numbers those players had, but I had to hold out to get paid the same amount of money those guys got paid. And my parents would always tell me, Anson, don't forget you're Black. You're not white. So it's going to be that much more difficult for you to get recognized or get paid the same amount as your peers, because that's what's happening right now. And that, to be honest with you, Erica, that never discouraged me. It was a reality. So I always thought, and that's why I do what I do now, is I want to make things better for the people coming behind me. When I played, I had locks. And there's a general manager out there that told me to cut my hair one time. And you guys probably see from my hockey cards, I never had a hockey card without locks once I started growing my hair. So I was stubborn. You're going to tell me what I didn't want to believe in. And I was true to who I am and who I was. And that's, I think, important for young boys and girls out there, that you've got to be true to who you are and have a strong belief in who you are. And it's important for parents out there too, to instill that belief in their children.
I remember you sharing that story. We were on that mobile exhibit that the NHL has had for Black History Month, and you shared that story. So thinking about that, Anson, what would you like to see the current NHL players take on when it comes to being able to embrace all players for who they are and what they bring to the sport, and to really amplify the message of diversity across the league?
Well, I'm seeing it happen right now. When you saw the return to play, and we had the postseason and the players stood together in solidarity and they didn't play, that told me everything I needed to know about the mindset of NHL players. The majority, I'd say 90, 95% of the league is white. It's not Black, but you saw players standing with Ryan Reeves, standing with Darnell Nurse, standing with Malcolm Subban, standing with Dumba, you know, in solidarity, because they recognize that equality isn't political. It's not something that we need to fight about. It's about doing the right thing. What do we teach our kids? What would our parents taught us growing up? Treat people how you want to be treated. And I'm seeing that within the league right now. So getting players' attention was probably the first thing, but now players are in tune with what's happening in society. And now we have everyone buying into just doing the right thing. It's not too much to ask.
Yes, absolutely. We saw the National Hockey League fall in step with a lot of other professional leagues when it came to the return to play. But Saroya, also in the NWHL, we saw that the league embraced the slogan End Racism, which was on all jerseys throughout the league. But you and a handful of other players took that to the next level and had a visible show of solidarity by kneeling during the national anthems. Can you talk through that a little bit and what you hoped that gesture that you and players like Brooke Stacey or Nina Rogers took during the anthems? What did you hope that message got across?
Yeah, for me, there are five Black women currently playing in my league. And with that, I think it showed that we are coming together as one and that our opinions and stances are being heard within our league. I think that it's so important for us as Black men and women to continue to stay strong together. And I also think it's important for people to know the history behind kneeling. I am aware that some people see it as disrespectful or whatnot, and everybody is of course entitled to their own opinion. But for us as Black players, I think it showed the solidarity that we have and want to have within our league. And by our league allowing us to do that, obviously we have action-based steps behind our end racism patches. And there's more going on behind the scenes that many don't know. But I think for us as Black players, it was so important for us to know that we could stand together and have our teammates support us as well as our league.
And I'd like to stay on that for both you, Anson, and Saroya. We actually have a question that comes from our audience. Thank you so much for joining us. But this question comes in from one of our audience members that's watching. The question is, what are effective ways that white people can be more actively supportive and inclusive of Black players, Black fans, and other players of color, BIPOC players and fans? And so why don't we start with you, Saroya?
Yeah, I think a lot of which I've tried to educate people on is how to be anti-racist. So staying silent does not count as one of those things. I think for allies, it's important that they're able to call out our teammates that may be still practicing those microaggressions and have those issues in the past and whatnot. But I do think that as allies, it's so important to learn the history, read so many books. There are so many books out there to educate ourselves and just be that person that we can go to, even though you may not be a Black individual in the game. I know for me, I want to be treated just like the rest of my teammates. And I think that it's so important for us to continue to do that and have those allies on our team.
Yeah, I agree, Saroya. I mean, participation is going to be the key, like just not sitting on the sidelines. You know, we look at the Players Inclusion Committee that I'm a co-chair with PK Subban as, and we have players like Jacob Slavin. Now we've got players like Kevin Shattenkirk. They're not Black or players of color, but they want to participate and get involved. It's about being a good teammate. If you're in a locker room and your teammate kept turning over the puck time and time again, causing your team to lose, would you not walk over your teammate and say, hey, knock it off? You're causing us, you know, these bad instances that's creating losses for a team. Well, that's the same thing about what we're talking about being a good teammate and being a good person. Like, that's all super important. Allyship, I can't state enough about how important that is to have people coming together and working within the group. And you talk about microaggressions. Well, you got to think about what you're saying too. A lot of times, and Erica, you're in the business now, the media business. Sorry, you're still playing. You might be in the media business at some point, but you're also an elite, you know, Ivy League students, so you probably get the same exact thing. It drives me crazy when people say, hey, Anson, you know, no wonder you're on the television because you speak so well. What do you mean I speak so well? Are you trying to say that Black people can't speak well? Like, what exactly? Like, no one would say that to my coworkers. So why is that? Or people would say, well, Anson, you speak and you sound like you're white. That's the thing that really triggers me the most. You sound white, Anson. You don't really sound Black. Well, Black people aren't supposed to put a sentence together. They're not supposed to know about enunciation, about grammar, about, you know, all that kind of stuff. And when I check people on that, like, oh, well, that's not what I meant. Well, what exactly do you mean? And I get that from white people and Black people too. So I think that's very important for people to understand.
I love that you added that, Anson, about microaggressions, because yes, you're absolutely right. As someone in media, I also experienced that. And even as a player, not in hockey, but in other sports. But that leads me to ask this question as a follow-up to that and to the question that came from the audience. Both of you are saying, and I agree, people need to stand up and speak out for what's right. I loved the analogy of, hey, if we're coughing up the puck, we're going to talk about that. We're going to figure it out. But there seems to be this space where we either have to be 100% right or we're 100% wrong. And I get the sense that conversations about racism often fail because there's this misconception that there's a perfect way to do everything at all points and times. But racism was created in a very messy and aggressive way. And I think it's going to take a little bit of patience and vulnerability to move us forward. So Anson, what would you say to that? And then we'll go to Saroya as well.
Well, you're right. There isn't a right way or wrong way. I think the fact that we're open to having these conversations, that's what's going to lead to solutions. Because when you're in a classroom and you're sitting there and you're a student, teacher is putting a math problem on the chalkboard, only way you learn is you raise your hand. You might get the answer wrong. However, the teacher will correct you and the next time you get the right answer. But not raising your hand, then you're not quite sure, right? So you don't know if 2 + 2 really equals 4. It might equal 5 in your brain. It might equal 1. But you don't know without asking or having these conversations. That's why it's so important to have these conversations, because you might not always say the right thing. But that's okay. That's how we learn. That's how we continue to grow. Just with the fact that we're willing to have these conversations, that's a big first step.
Yeah, for me, I couldn't agree more. I think in terms of my conversations with my team and the league around me, I think the biggest thing is asking questions and getting comfortable being uncomfortable. Additionally, I think the two things that I've stressed to my teammates is that we can always have kindness and respect for other people. Those are two big things that we can stress on and obviously make change with. I think that in terms of equality, if you treat your teammates, your coworkers with kindness and respect, those things easily start to diminish as we as people just simply respect each other. For me, I think that's the biggest thing that I've stressed, but also people having questions, ask questions, educate yourself and make an effort to do so.
Yes, I 100% agree with both of you. I would also add that we have to listen to one another. It's sometimes uncomfortable to hear that you are wrong or that something that you said was hurtful or harmful, especially if that wasn't your intent. Even if it was your intent, that can be difficult, but we have to listen and appreciate what people are saying and believe them when they say that they have been negatively affected by something that we have said or done. Which takes me to another question that we have from our amazing audience. How can we effectively promote hockey in communities of color, the Black community, BIPOC communities overall? What are some ways that you think, and we'll start with Saroya and then go to Anson, that we can uplift the communities, the BIPOC communities that are already in hockey and those who want to learn hockey?
Yeah, I think that one of the biggest pieces is accessibility. For me, I know that I've put a lot of my efforts into raising money for scholarship funds and stuff like that. For me, I think growing up in a low-income household, I wasn't always able to have new equipment. I wasn't able to be as involved in the game as I would have hoped. And obviously, I think that accessibility is huge, and it's not, hockey is one of those games that's expensive and you need access to the rink, you need access to ice, all those types of things. But I think for me personally, I think accessibility is going to be huge. And if we can provide those Black players and players of color with the equipment and the ice time that they need and deserve to be involved with the game, that's something that is so exciting and something that will definitely push the game forward.
Yeah, you can gain.
Hold on, Anson, before you get into, I want you to talk a little bit about accessibility, but I want to pump Saroya's tires a little bit here while you talked about some of the work that you're doing. And Anson, I'll do the same for you, I promise. But can you tell us a little bit more about that work that you're doing in community, what that looks like, and how people can engage and get involved with the work that you're actively doing?
Yeah, so currently I have my GoFundMe fundraiser for Black Girl Hockey Club up and running, since it'll be going until the end of the NWHL bubble season. Currently we've raised $25,000 for Black women in hockey, and they will be provided with scholarships moving forward. I also take time out of my day to mentorship a lot of my younger girls that I'm in contact with. My mentorship program is free, and I just love to engage with the younger girls and see where they're going and where their hopes and dreams lie. But yeah, I've always made an effort to be involved within my community and strive for those things that I think are huge in terms of making the hockey community more diverse. So thank you for pointing that out, Erica.
Well, Hold on a second. You can't just mention mentorship and not tell the viewing audience how you get involved with that mentorship. Like, how, if I've got someone who wants to get down with that, how do we get involved with that, Saroya?
Apple to Anson, apple for Anson Carter. Yes, let's have it, Saroya. Let us know where we can follow you.
Yes, I'm sorry. I'm new to this. I'm getting used to it. But my platform is Saroya Tinker 71 on all forms of social media. The links on there can take you to my website. And yeah, we can book it. You can book an appointment. I believe my email's on there, obviously, as well. But yeah, I would love to hear from these young ladies.
Excellent. Excellent. All right, Anson, you're up now. First, let's talk about getting BIPOC communities, players, fans of color involved in hockey. And then again, we get to pump your tires and let us know what you're doing and how we can get involved in your efforts.
Well, that's why sports is so special, Erica. You know, you just talk about Saroya's efforts, what she's doing, and sports is that vehicle that brings strangers together. You know, you could help teach kids through sports. Like, you think about playing hockey. What's that one tool you learn when you play hockey? You got to skate, and you're going to fall down, and you got to get up. And that's a muscle you have to learn and develop. And you're going to use that throughout your whole life. And we want to use those to teach kids through hockey about trying to become better people. So I know Saroya is doing her thing, and it's not just one person. There's several different programs that are out there. So we're also developing team hockey with the New York Rangers. It's a pilot program in the Bronx and Kips Bay. We've got Chase as one of our tremendous partners, one of our sponsors. We have Bauer, another partner of ours too. We're providing full gear, head to toe. You know what expensive gear is? Saroya was talking about accessibility. Gear is super expensive. Bauer's providing gear from head to toe for these kids. We're going to provide locally sourced meals for these kids as well. A 10-week program, one on-ice session practice, one game. But we also want to diversify the game off the ice too. So there's going to be a financial literacy component in there to teach kids about how you deal with money. There's going to be a civic component, but we want to take it one step further, because I've been talking to JD, John Davidson, president of the Rangers, who everyone knows, and we want to have a career day, a virtual career day. So we'll have like the head of fan development, head of marketing, maybe Coach Quinn, Coach Davidson. You'll be on talking to these kids and their parents, so that maybe hockey's not their thing to play, but the business of hockey might resonate with them. So this is going to open other doors off the ice for these kids too. So I can't be thankful enough for the New York Rangers. Rick Nadeau has been unbelievable with the Rangers and his support. Chase, like I said, Bauer, the NHL Industry Growth Fund, the NHLPA, like, we have to have partners, and that's why it's called team. I know I'm rambling on, but team, I can't stress enough. Together, everyone achieves more. It just can't be Saroya. It just can't be Anson. It just can't be Erica. It has to be done as a community, and that's the only way we'll make the game better.
Oh, well, I'm fired up for what both of you are doing in the community. But before we let you go, we have just a couple of minutes here. Today, of course, is the first day of Black History Month 2021. So Anson, we'll start with you, and then we'll end off with Saroya before getting into our next panel. What does Black History Month and the importance of celebrating Black history as a part of North American history and hockey history mean to you, Anson?
It's important. It means a lot to me because it brings and it highlights and brings to the forefront all the accomplishments that Black individuals have had and accomplished in the sport of hockey and just in this world, period. But I want to stress, and I can't stress enough, that it's not just a moment that we're focused on right now. Kim Davis and myself in the NHL, we always talk about it being a movement. That's one of Kim's favorite phrases, and I love it. I stole it from her. I use it all the time. So yes, we're highlighting these accomplishments within the Black community, but also let's not forget that once February is over and done with, let's put it out of sight, out of mind. We need to keep continuing to start talking about diversity, equality, and inclusion. That should be a part of our everyday conversation 365 days a year.
Absolutely. And Saroya, we'll leave the last word for you. Same question. What does the celebration of Black History Month and Black hockey history mean to you?
Yeah, I think for Black History Month, for me, I'm always excited. I know, being Black myself, I already know that I don't know everything based on my own history, and that I want to continue to learn. So with Black History Month, it excites me because you get to continue to learn. I always get new book recommendations that I didn't even know of. There's always so much room for education. And not only education for those of our white counterparts, but also for us as Black individuals as well. So I think that for me, it means that we still have so much to learn and so much to get to know about each other and about other cultures. So I think for me, I definitely am focused on educating myself further on these matters and continuing to push the game forward.
Well, Anson, Saroya, thank you so much to you both for joining us tonight and for opening up about your own experiences and sharing how we can forge a path together for the future. So we really value that and we thank you so very much. But now it is time for our second panel. So I would like to introduce you to Jeff Scott, the Vice President of Community Development and Growth for the NHL, Malik Garvin, Director of Ice Hockey in Harlem, and Stephanie Jackson, Director of Diversity and Inclusion for USA Hockey. Jeff, Malik, and Stephanie, thank you so much for joining us this evening.
Thank you, Eric.
For having us.
Thank you.
Excellent, excellent. Well, we are going to keep the party going. And Jeff, we're going to start with you as someone who is representing the NHL. We know that February is also a time where we are focused on Hockey is for Everyone. Can you walk us through that campaign a little bit and what the NHL is doing to spread the good word of the hockey game and make it more of a diverse sport?
Yeah, thank you, first off, Erica, and of course, the Rangers for allowing us to have this platform. You know, Black History Month is a time where I think is extremely important, you know, and to your question around what does the Hockey is for Everyone platform mean for us? First off, it's, you know, there's some conversation around what does it mean, right? And we'll be the first one to tell you that this platform is not intended to serve as an accomplishment, but it's intended, of course, for us to look at the game as to where we want to go, where we want to be. We want people to see this sport as a sport that is open and welcoming to everyone. So that's the point around our Hockey is for Everyone platform, is that, you know, it's not a tagline, it's not a hashtag, it's not a rally cry, but this is culture, right? This is what we're trying to accomplish as a league, as a hockey ecosystem, honestly. So what we've, you know, been able to accomplish with the Hockey is for Everyone platform is that we've been able to be extremely pointed on who we want to target, how we want to target, where we want to target our community-based initiatives, right? Especially when it comes to engaging under-indexed and underrepresented communities. So to quickly paint the picture for you of what it looks like is we've tried to take our season, right? Over the course of this 7 months, you know, that we're actively playing or however many months, and break it down, right? So in a traditional world or a year, right, when we're not battling COVID and the season would have started in September and October, our focus is around Hispanic heritage, right, and engaging the Hispanic community. As we would transition into November, we're focused on a very health-based focus, and that's where Hockey Fights Cancer has its home. As we move into December, we're focused on individuals with disabilities, right, so understanding that this is another very important sector of our outreach effort to, you know, as those individuals who are in love and playing the game, but playing with a disability. And then of course, as we just closed out with January, we knew that we were highlighting MLK Day. We also know that we're highlighting the man who broke the color barrier here in the NHL in Willie O'Ree and celebrating the life and legacy that surrounds that moment. And then of course, here we are now, February 1, and we've jumped into the Black contributions, right, and celebrating Black history. As it continues to go on, March, Gender Equality Month. Then we go into April, right, and we're looking into Asian and Pacific Islanders and understanding the heritage and contributions to that aspect. May, June, we get into our LGBTQ community. So when you look at the efforts that we're trying to do is we want everyone of all walks of life, of all different arms, you know, areas of the globe to understand that hockey and the NHL is a platform for us to be able to amplify the beautiful diversity of our sport. And we're committed to that. So this platform gives us that opportunity to do it.
Jeff, I appreciate you walking us through that because it's not just hockey is for everyone, but it's for everybody.
Everybody.
Okay. For everybody, a todos, okay, we are here. I love that you walked us through month by month. And those are opportunities to highlight and elevate certain groups, offer accessibility, but also hopefully ways that we can impart that every day in our hockey journey. So Malik, we're going to come to you. I'm here in East Harlem right now. It's a little bit cold. You know, the wind's blowing on my window here, but I would love to talk about ice hockey in Harlem and how you take that aspirational message and campaign that Jeff just talked about, and you make manifest and you make that a reality for young people, especially in my community of Harlem.
Awesome. Thank you, Erica. It's pond hockey weather. So what we do is we serve 150 boys and girls this year due to COVID restrictions. Normally it would be 350 boys and girls age 5 to 18. And first and foremost, the thing we take care of is accessibility. As mentioned in the first panel, our program is completely free of charge. So everyone receives equipment from head to toe, and then they play a full hockey season. We operate out of Alaska Rink in Central Park, New York. And our families are low income. They're all from the neighborhood. You have to live in Harlem. And the game means as much, if not to more, to them as it does to any single other person, any other kid that's out there playing. It's obviously a non-traditional hockey market, but the culture's big. The history of our program is big. We've been around for 30 years. You guys can check us out on icehockeyinharlem.org, www.icehockeyinharlem.org. And we're really thriving right now. We're lucky to be playing during COVID. We're at an outdoor rink, and the kids and the families absolutely love hockey.
You love to hear it, especially, like I said, in a community that's very near and dear, not just to me, but to my family. But Stephanie, I would like to bring you into the conversation now. So we've heard what's happening at the NHL. We've heard what's happening, as I said, in my hood right here in Harlem. But you represent an organization that is looking to make hockey accessible, is looking to encourage and embrace hockey communities from all throughout the United States. So tell us a little bit about how USA Hockey is looking to diversify the sport at all stages and at all entry points of the game.
Yeah, well, first and foremost, Erica, thanks so much for having me. And thank you to the New York Rangers for inviting me to be in the company of Malik and Jeff. I'm very, very, very grateful. So at USA Hockey, we have been having these conversations about diversity at every single level of our organization. And I can tell you that there is not a stopping point. We are continuing to talk about how we can look like the communities that we serve here in the United States of America. And it's an ever-changing, ever-evolving process. We work very, very, very closely with our associations, our districts, our affiliates, and all of their leaderships to figure out how can we create more pipelines to attract people from diverse backgrounds, as well as the pipelines that we already have in place. How can we strengthen those so that we can be much more attractive to get non-traditional people in the USA Hockey system. So it's not a one size fits all thing. We realize that every geographic region is different and it has different wants and needs. And so every day we're trying to figure out how we can work within the cultures that we have throughout USA Hockey to make sure that we can be as diverse as possible. So there's not a magic answer as of right now, but for the most part, we are trying to figure it out just like everyone else. And I think that one of the things that I like to say is that we have great partners in doing that. The National Hockey League has definitely been there with us, you know, day in and day out, helping us kind of figure out how we can be a little bit more out in the community. So there's no magic answer, but at the same time, we are just working every day to just work with our communities and see how we can make sure that we can get all of those entry points that we can.
And you know, I have to gas you up as well, Stephanie, because I know that you are definitely looking to embrace all, again, entry points, as we mentioned earlier. And you mentioned that there's no one size fits all. And that's because not all people of color, BIPOC players and fans, are a monolith. We represent very unique cultures. Mm-hmm. We represent very unique languages and unique circumstances that make us brilliant for who we are and what we bring to hockey. But also we know that some of that has to, as far as changing hockey culture, we have to be able to identify different data points that we want to impact. And so Jeff, I believe it was you earlier, you mentioned Willie O'Ree. It's 60 years since he became the first Black player to play in the National Hockey League in 1958 for the Boston Bruins. But right now we have a data point that tells us that less than 5% of NHL players are Black or people of color as far as how they culturally identify. So when it comes to hockey culture, can you shed some light, Jeff, on how the NHL is working to improve that culture, not just on the ice, but how maybe making some changes on the ice and in the locker rooms will also maybe impact the overall hockey experience and the fan experience as well?
Yeah, that's a great question. And it's actually been 63 years since Willie broke, right? And, you know, when you think about how much has happened or lack thereof over those 63 years, you know, you do have to take a step back and look into the reasons why, right? Why the growth trajectory has not gone as steep and as steady as we like. But the key word that we're talking about here is culture, right? And when you talk about culture is something that I think you have to manage your expectations and realize that culture doesn't happen overnight, right? Especially when you're talking about a culture so rich as that hockey has. So from an NHL's perspective, we've had to honestly look inward, right? You can't really inflict a change or a cultural shift externally, if you really don't turn around and look inwardly and say, what does our culture look like from a league's perspective? So what we've been adamant about, and this is work that is fairly new. And when I say new, you know, over the past couple of years here, is understanding the various elements that are able to drive change within the game. And so what we've been doing is we've been establishing a series of councils and committees. And the reason why we're putting this in is that we shouldn't be the ones or think that we have the answers to everything. We need to seek sources externally, right? And bring more people into this think tank so that when we are strategizing and creating opportunities and just a new way forward, we have a very diverse lens and thought process into our efforts. So to quickly kind of paint that picture as to what we've been doing is, you know, it all started off with, as I mentioned, these councils and committees, and where the top meets is our executive inclusion committee. And this is led by Commissioner Bettman and Kim Pegula, right? So we know that if change wants to happen, it needs to happen from the top down as well as the bottom up. So our executive inclusion committee is kind of at the top of the chain here. And from there, we have our fan inclusion committee, which is made up of individuals in the NHL and across our clubs, as well as external folks. We have our player inclusion committee, which Anson mentioned, you know, in the previous session, where he and PK are the co-chairs of this committee. So that's comprised of, I believe, 5 or 6 current players, 5 or 6 alumni players. But the beauty that I see also is that there's 6 female, you know, players that are also a part of that, right? So we're not just talking about how to grow the game for men in hockey, but we're looking at it from the entire spectrum. So that female participation, you know, was something that we prioritized. And then, you know, Stephanie has the privilege, you know, and pleasure to sit on our youth hockey inclusion committee. So when you think about it across the entire spectrum, we're starting at the executives, we're looking at it from a fan's lens, we're looking at it from a player lens, we're looking at it from a youth hockey inclusion lens. And then I'd also like to add from our youth hockey inclusion committee, we have Pat Kelleher and we have Scott Smith. So these are the tops of both Hockey Canada and USA Hockey that are a part of these conversations with us. You know, so this is something that from an NHL's perspective, we're extremely passionate about. you know, and not only passionate about just bringing people together, but also making sure that where we're investing is also a part of this. Not only talking about it from investing in our arenas and our stadiums, right, and our teams, but at a youth hockey perspective, right, looking at it from all lenses. And then the last thing, you know, that I want to add, that's also a part of these councils and committees, is that we also have an internal inclusion steering committee. So this is just all NHL employees, so that we can understand what our organization looks like internally. So how do we improve our hiring practices, right? How do we improve our overall approach when it comes to strategically prioritizing our objectives as an organization? So all in all, you know, we feel like this is the blueprint. This is what's going to help that culture make the shift, so that when we're talking about diversity, we're not talking about it as just, you know, an A or a B thing, but we're talking about it across the entire alphabet and everyone that has and should be a part of hockey.
Jeff, I appreciate you walking us through some of the internal structure of the National Hockey League and how you are also including other aspects, like you mentioned, women professionals in hockey, whether players or coaches, etc. And Stephanie, I've heard you speak enough about USA Hockey to know that I know you like to identify that USA Hockey has a membership base. And so when you're talking about internal and external communication, that requires talking to a broad membership base. Can you illuminate some of the things that you at US and USA Hockey, your colleagues at USA Hockey have done to be able to tap into what's happening and the conversations that people are having or that they want to have when it comes to diversity and inclusion, but then also ways that you are amplifying and elevating communities that already exist in USA Hockey and hockey culture?
Yeah, definitely, Erica. And kind of like Jeff said, it definitely is an internal and external approach. What I like to say is that we at USA Hockey, we have gone into two partnerships, one with White Men as Full Diversity Partners, as well as with RISE. And so really since last June, we have engaged in many conversations at every single level of USA Hockey about diversity, equity, and inclusion, and what it has looked like for the USA Hockey landscape, what it looks like now, and what we hope it will look like in the future. And so with these conversations, we have received conversations from an internal organizational backdrop, but then with RISE, we have explored it from a community-based lens. And so in those conversations, we have talked about everything from equality versus equity, to empathy, to microaggressions, to inclusive leadership and what that looks like, what it sounds like, what it feels like. So we are in the thrust of these conversations. And in that thrust of these conversations, we're all trying to figure out what our place is in terms of this transformation that we want to make. So at every level, the conversations have been very, very, very fluid. I think a lot of people are recognizing things about themselves that they didn't know before, or they are seeing things that they knew in themselves that they wanted to change. And so with this conversational education that we've been having, I mean, we did start at the top. We started with our senior leadership up under Pat Kelleher, as well as we moved to our executive committee. And then in a couple of weeks, we will our next cohort will start with our board of directors. And then from then on, we will go to our staff, and then we will kind of trickle it down to all of our affiliate presidents. So we're kind of taking smaller cohorts to have these conversations simply because we want people to learn. And I think for us, a big deal is sustainability. We want this to be sustainable. We don't want to just make a change just for the sake of the moment. We want to make sure that we are setting a foundation for that change to lead us in to the next 20, 30 years. And so for us, some things may appear a little bit slower than the speed of the community, but there is a method to that slowness, because we really want to try to make sure that we get a grasp on how this transformation is going to not only impact USA Hockey, but how it will impact our communities. Because for us, that is our investment, and grassroots is our investment. It's the way that we do everything at USA Hockey. So that has been kind of the levels and the layers of our educational process that we have embarked upon as of this moment.
And Stephanie, there's so much that you said there, which really makes me want to toss this one over to Malik, because the nonprofit sector, generally speaking, has a lot of the keys to what organizations and institutions attempt to do as far as policy change and internal structure. And so Malik, I'd like for you first to walk us through the mission of ice hockey in Harlem, and then we'll get into a little bit more about how the mission and just the necessity of the program itself in Harlem has led to organically a lot of what we hear Stephanie and Jeff talking about.
Right. So our mission is to improve academic and athletic opportunities for kids in the Harlem community. We do that through exposing them first and foremost to a non-traditional sport. And with that comes non-traditional opportunities for kids in the neighborhood. Hockey is just a small part of what we do. We would love to develop everyone into an NHL or WNHL player, but it's really the carrot to get players to buy into bigger things, into things they're passionate about, to take the qualities and the skills they develop on the ice, hard work, and take that and use that in other aspects of their life. So we do have our full season, in season, and then we do enrichment programming as well. We've also partnered with RISE, as Stephanie mentioned. So we have players having important conversations around race and identity and the power of sports. And we want to form We want to form good citizens, strong people who can then come back and uplift their community, go on and do great things for themselves and their families. For our younger players, we do a hockey knowledge series where they get to learn about the geography of the teams, the players, how the NHL works. And we also do college visits for our players, which have been halted for now due to COVID. But we take our kids out and we expose them to different things. So they get to see things that other kids in the neighborhood don't get to see. And do what they want with it. Hockey's just a small part of what we do. And the enrichment programming is also a part of it. And then in the summertime, we send our kids to camp all over the Canada and US. So they get to go out, they get to meet people from different cultures, skate in different places, try different things. And I'll note, since I've mentioned Canada, I'd like to thank the Canadian Association of New York, CANNY. Big supporters of ours, Rena Batt, Dean, Ken Ottenbright, and of course the Rangers and the Rangers Alumni Association. So as Jeff mentioned, we're going out. We want everyone's input into how we can do better, what's going on in other places. I'm a part of the Hockey is for Everyone conversation, and we're looking for continued support. All of our fundraisers have been put to a halt due to COVID because they were all in person. We're working on virtual fundraisers, but we're really tapping all of our networks to keep this going as strong as possible, because at the end of the day, it's for kids. It's all about the kids, and they're truly passionate. And our kids right now are showing up to the rink in 30-degree weather with their gear on, and they put their skates on outside and their helmet on, and they go on the ice. And their parents stand outside the entire time, and the coaches the same thing. They show up ready to go. So I think that speaks to the power of what we're doing. And we want to keep it going, just growing and getting it better.
I love that you shared that. And what I hear you saying, Malik, is that in some ways hockey is the hook, right? But the meat and potatoes, if you will, is the enrichment. And I wonder what feedback you get from people that go through the Ice Hockey in Harlem program as far as how they're able to progress through not just their hockey career, wherever that may take them, but through life when it comes to, as Saroya said, not just embracing their culture, but also learning and appreciating their culture, and also learning and appreciating places, I think as Stephanie mentioned, where they can improve and grow as people.
Right. So I just want to mention, I am an Ice Hockey in Harlem alumni, sort of how this has come full circle. I started playing hockey with Ice Hockey in Harlem when I was 3 years old, and now I am the program director. I grew up with a Hockey is for Everyone poster with Anson Carter and Willie O'Ree on my wall. So I was sort of obsessed with hockey and I took it and ran with it. We have board members, JJ Velez is an Ice Hockey Home alumni, who's on our board now. I think that for the feedback from people who participate in our program is that it had a profound impact on their life. And it's like the single thing that got them to where they are, right? Whether they work for the city, whether they're in college right now, it's a single thing that sort of gave them meaning and something to hang on to and a sense of community. And that's what got them where they are. And they're super appreciative for that. And it's a driving factor. It changes the trajectory of people's lives. And I think that many of our participants will say that. It changed the trajectory of my life. And whether or not they still skate, I know I see it on Facebook all the time. They post about the Rangers, all that stuff. So we're talking about all kinds of people, Black, Brown, Hispanic, who love hockey. Now their kids love hockey. They're getting their kids into hockey. And I think it's important for people to know that hockey has been big in Harlem for over 30 years. There's a hockey culture in Harlem, whether you know it or not. Again, we're 15 minutes from Madison Square Garden. So there's a hockey culture in Harlem.
Hey, and you know what, Erica, that's one of the things that I just want to just point out really quickly. Sure. I think Malik couldn't have expressed what he just said any better, because I think sometimes people tend to think that there are pockets of the United States of America where people from diverse backgrounds are not playing the game, or that they're not even having conversations about hockey. And that's not necessarily the truth. And I even found that out the first year on the job, where I went out everywhere meeting everybody. And I found that there are lots of places that are doing just what Malik said. And so I think whenever we talk about what the future of hockey is going to look like, I think that it is important that we make sure that we include some of the people that are involved in hockey and are having hockey conversations that maybe are not necessarily aligned with a USA Hockey or even an NHL. We can't assume that these demographics don't exist in hockey, because they do.
You know, I love that, because I don't know if anyone said this, so maybe I'll claim it, but I mean, hockey gone hockey, right? If you love hockey, you're going to find a way to be engaged. And it's just a matter of tapping into those different communities. We do have a question from our fantastic audience that I'm going to read in a moment. But going off of that, now is the perfect time to give our community spotlight. And Malik, the community spotlight is going to you. For over 30 years, the New York Rangers have partnered with Ice Hockey in Harlem to enrich the lives of children in the Harlem community. Malik, your passion and dedication will continue to serve and inspire the next generation of players and the Harlem community. So congrats to you, clap it up, stick taps for Malik Garvin and all of Ice Hockey in Harlem for all of the work that you are doing. And the Rangers would like to acknowledge you and the work that you and your colleagues do as the community spotlight. But as I mentioned, we do have a question from our audience, and it goes to a lot of what we were just talking about. How are we going to encourage young children and BIPOC players to try hockey? How can we tap into where young people are that have this curiosity for hockey? So Stephanie, I know you kind of led us off on this, so we'll continue with you and then go to Jeff and Malik.
First and foremost, I think it's exposure and it's engagement. And I think for us at USA Hockey, that is what we are intending to do. And that is what we are planning to do, to make sure that our arm is a lot longer than it's been within our community, so that we can expose as many kids and their families to the game of hockey, so that we can get them into our pipeline and grow with them.
Yeah, and to add to that, I mean, Stephanie, I think you hit the nail right on the head. Access is key, right? But I also think we have to expand our horizon and not just think of access as playing hockey on the ice, right? There are so many, you know, various forms of hockey that I think once you expose kids to that, whether it's ball hockey or street hockey or even video game, right? You know, NHL 21 is a hit in the Scott household right here. And it's so funny how, you know, when my son, who is a hockey player, I'll add, plays some of his other friends who aren't hockey players, what's the first thing they want to do? They want to then pick up a stick, you know, and go out into the street or in the basement and play ball hockey. And then what's going to happen from there? Then they're going to want to lace up the skates and hop on there. So I think if we can just continue acknowledging the various on-ramps, you know, to the sport, regardless if, like I said, if it's ice or other non-traditional forms, guess what? We're creating hockey fans. And that's the beauty of it. You're bringing people into this family network of just a beautiful game. So I couldn't echo what Stephanie said any better, but access is the key. And once we can get beyond that, then you just watch them take off, right?
I love it. And Malik, you aren't new, but certainly true to a lot of what Stephanie and Jeff have already mentioned. So I'm going to remix this for you a little bit. What are ways that those of us that are engaging with you on this panel, and for those watching and listening in, how can we support the work that you and Ice Hockey in Harlem are doing?
So again, our website is www.icehockeyinharlem.org. We could use all kinds of support, right? Obviously donations are great. Our fundraising has been out, but we want to build partnerships with like-minded organizations. We live in a virtual world now. If you can hop on a Zoom, anyone, and provide something meaningful, we're happy to do that. Internships for our kids, just any kind of opportunity for someone to better themselves is what we're looking for. And again, we do everything. So we do the virtual hockey workouts, we do on ice workouts, we do enrichment programming. So the support is really endless in the ways that we can be supported, and we're happy to look into anything.
And so we are going to conclude our panel. We know that this is just the tip of the iceberg, so to speak, that there is a lot more listening, learning, and of course, coordinating to do with our communities. But at this time, I would like to mention that the Rangers and Chase will be donating $20,000 to support the Ice Hockey in Harlem Scholarship Program. So there are things that are happening, and we hope that everyone watching and listening, you will engage as well. But at this time, I would like to thank you, Jeff, Malik, and Stephanie, for joining us tonight. It was an absolute honor to talk with you all virtually and learn a little bit about the steps you all are taking in the hockey world to improve diversity in the sport. Of course, we have to give some stick taps and love to Anson Carter and Saroya Tinker, who joined us on the first panel. Them sharing their experiences, we know, will change their trajectory for not just those who want to be hockey players, but even for people like me who find their way into media. So for everyone, we hope that you continue having these very important conversations, find your voice in this space. And on behalf of Chase and the New York Rangers, thank you for joining us for tonight's pregame panel discussion. We will continue the celebration of Black history at tonight's Rangers game against the Penguins, and of course, throughout the month of February and beyond. So for now, I wish you well, stay safe, stay warm, and hey, let's go Rangers!